My two kids are 7 and 5, a boy and a girl. All right. My kids are 7 and 3. So I was really moved by this. And they rinse with mouthwash every night. Would that cause any complications creating nitric oxide at a young age? Their mouthwash contains sodium fluoride 0.05%. So let's slow down a little bit and let me remind you what mouthwash does from nitric oxide production, but what it just does in general too, because we focus a lot on nitric oxide, but there's also even a bigger picture, which I think what you got to keep in mind is that when you're using mouthwash, what mouthwash is generally designed to do, whether it's through fluoride or alcohol or whatever's in it, is it's designed to kill off bacteria. Well, the problem with mouthwash is that it is potentially killing off good bacteria too, the bacteria that we need. Now, that bacteria in our mouth is so important for us as we age for nitric oxide production, but it's important for overall health, for oral health. And if you follow me, you'll know that our overall oral health represents our general mental health. Now, I also want to point out that he said that there's fluoride in his mouthwash that the kids are using. Now, I also want to remind you that although fluoride is in the majority of our toothpaste, fluoride is a neurotoxin, which really means it is toxic to nerves. And the reason we know this is because one of the biggest villains of all time, Hitler, he and the Third Reich did a lot of experiments using fluoride as a neurotoxin to destroy lives, to destroy people. And so that's oftentimes why you see people like myself trying to avoid fluoride in toothpaste for our kids. So does a little bit of fluoride go a long way? Maybe, but there's fluoride in our water. There's fluoride in our toothpaste. Now there's fluoride in the mouthwash. We don't want the kids getting too much fluoride because it can interfere with their neurological development. So that's one thing. You do not want your kids using mouthwash that has fluoride in it because it's a neurotoxic, but you also don't want them to have too much fluoride because you also don't want them to use mouthwash because it's destroying the good bacteria in their mouth and it's throwing things off, right? And it can potentially cause something in the teeth called fluorosis. And you may have seen it. They're little kids, they get their permanent teeth in and then they've got spots, maybe some pitting, maybe some discoloration or streaking. Too much fluoride mouthwash could cause that. So my short and my long is that kids should not be using mouthwash. Honestly, you should try not to use it either. But when it comes to our kids, you really don't want to do it. And I also want to point out this study too, that I think will surprise you. It's a study that was published, you know, a few years back that basically talks about a connection between mouthwash and, let me see. I took a picture of it so I could show it to you. And I think we've talked about it once before. It is an association between mouthwash and the risk of diabetes. Okay? And I'm putting this up here like this because I want to remind you that when it comes to oral health, it's all really connected. So now we already have kids, like an estimated 3,700 young people develop diabetes a year, right? This type 2 diabetes. Used to be no kids got type 2 diabetes. Now we have lots of kids getting type 2 diabetes. And when they look at it, of course, whose kids are getting type 2 diabetes more rapidly than others? Of course, it's the minority children, African-American and Mexican kids. And the CDC researchers made this prediction back in 2000 that 1 in 3 kids born in the United States of America at some point in their lives would likely develop diabetes unless they made some changes in their diet and things like that. So all of this information, including the information about mouthwash and it being linked to an increased association with diabetes type 2, All of this information points to the fact that you should not be using mouthwash unless you absolutely have to. Sure, every now and then your breath is going to be to the point where it can raise the dead. And in those situations, go ahead and get some. Swish it around, spit it out. Don't be afraid to suck on a mint at that point. Don't be afraid to chew some gum at that point. I don't want you afraid, but I do want you aware of the fact that if you destroy the good bacteria in your mouth, your body will not be able to use that oral pathway to produce nitric oxide. And why is nitric oxide so important? Because our blood vessels need nitric oxide to relax, to normalize blood pressure, and to increase blood flow. That's just one of the reasons nitric oxide is so important. There are plenty more, but that's the basics. So I love that question because it points to the fact that, not only when you're hearing this information, are you thinking about yourself, but you're thinking about your loved ones and how this impacts your kids and your wife or your boyfriend or your husband or whoever, your parents even. And that's exactly how I exist in this space, is I'm constantly looking for answers to make my family healthier and to make myself healthier. And I applaud you for doing the exact same stuff. Yes. Yes. Then what's the next best thing to keep your breath fresh if not mouthwashing? So brushing our teeth, of course, is important. Flossing. Because a lot of times when you have bad breath, it's because the food has gotten stuck in between your teeth and it's kind of decaying and rotting there. So making sure you're flossing a couple times each day, brushing, but also you can start to employ tongue brushing. And tongue brushing is you take this kind of metallic thing. I'll actually bring my tongue brush next time. I won't brush my tongue for you because it's kind of disgusting. And you're actually running it along your tongue to kind of actually remove some of the bad stuff that's there. So there is really good data that tongue scraping is way more healthy for you than mouthwash, and it can actually help freshen up your breath. So you're saying mouthwash is discouraged. I thought it was designed to move plaque out of the gums or teeth like floss. No. So if you think about it, basically, look at the bottle of different mouthwashes. They have alcohol in it. They've got fluoride in it. They've got antiseptic things. So we've been conditioned to think that killing off bacteria is a wonderful thing. But I think now we have to redo our thought process on that, because now we know we have commensal flora, commensal bacteria, which is so important for our day-to-day activity. Our hearts, our brains, our urinary tract, everything is under the control of certain bacteria. And when that bacteria gets thrown off, all hell can break loose. This is how important bacteria is, right? So think about it this way. Scientists were studying obesity, and they had some lab mice that were designed genetically to be fat. They had some lab mice that were designed genetically to be thin. They take the poop, the bacteria poop, from the skinny mice and put it into the fat mice, and guess what happens? The fat mice start to get skinny. They take the poop from the fat mice and put it in the skinny mice, and guess what happens? The skinny mice start to get fat. And why is that? It's because of the bacteria there. So we've got special bacteria in our mouth, special bacteria in our GI tract, special bacteria all over the body. And if you're using antibacterial soap for your body, you're using antibacterial mouthwash. You're trying to kill off all the bacteria. Potentially what you're doing is you're chipping away at your immune system, and you are removing from your body the bacteria that's supposed to be there to help keep you healthy and in a really positive space. That's why when you go on an antibiotic these days, most doctors will tell you to take a probiotic with it and afterwards for about a month, because we want to replace the good bacteria that could be killed off. Now imagine killing your bacteria off twice a day because you're swishing and spitting it out, right? And remember, that bacteria is 100% necessary for one of your pathways to produce nitric oxide. So some of you start on my smoothies, or they start on one of the recommended nitric oxide boosting supplements, right? And then I get an email that says, hey doc, I don't know, these test strips, they're not turning pink for me. What could be the problem? Well, if you don't have the bacteria necessary to convert the nitrates to a nitrite, which can then be stored and used to make nitric oxide, then you're not making nitric oxide levels like you should, and that test strip is not going to turn pink on you, right? So when you start on the supplement or you start on the smoothies, now what the body is actually doing is it's kind of recovering. So you haven't been able to make the nitric oxide that you've been able to make for a while. Now the body starting to get the nitrates that it needs. It starts to kind of recover and the system repairs itself. But if you continue to destroy that bacteria in your mouth, now we're missing a potential pathway that we need that's really necessary for the production of nitric oxide. Fortunately, our body has multiple ways to make nitric oxide. But unfortunately or fortunately, that nitrate pathway is one of the major ones, which is why you can take the nitric oxide boosting supplement or the smoothie recipes and see results fairly quickly. Because now what we're doing is we're supporting that nitric oxide pathway. But like I said, if you're eating a bunch of spinach and arugula and celery and all those things, and you a chronic mouthwash user, they're not working. And so I can take a guy, comes in, says, Dr. Ross, used to come in. Dr. Ross, I don't know what's happening. I am 45 and my erections are suffering. And we go through and we look at lifestyle. And we look at all these different things that they're doing. If mouthwash is one of those things, we remove mouthwash. I convince them, listen, mouthwash, let me tell you, I have to really convince you that it's a problem. Otherwise, you're going to be like, mouthwash, yeah, right. We go through the pathways. We do some education. He stops using the mouthwash and boosts his nitrates. It's almost like, ta-da! It's like I waved a magic wand. You know, I get the thank you notes with barely doing much of anything. And that's why I can help guys millions of miles away from me with erectile issues, is because there's some basic things that we know and some basic things that stay the same throughout. And mouthwash is going to eventually destroy erectile health. But here's the bad part, is it can eventually also destroy arterial health. Because remember, those same arteries that are going to the D and to the erection are going to your heart, your kidneys, your brain. So we want healthy blood vessels. And the best way to keep those healthy is to support that nitric oxide production pathway in our mouth. And you don't want to destroy that and throw that off by swishing and spitting hydrogen peroxide, mouthwash, any of that stuff, more than just once or twice a week. Awesome.